So everybody, we're going to get started.
Good evening. I've heard you've had amazing breakout groups. I've heard that you've come up with new business models. Many, many great ideas here. This is really awesome. And now for, I think, a conversation that I am very eager to hear. We are so honored to have Chief Justice Ralph Gants here. And, you know, everybody here knows him, but that doesn't mean I don't get to introduce him. So, you know, of course, we're very proud of him here at the Harvard Law School and at Harvard University, where he was a star student both as an undergrad and here at the law school. And went on to be an assistant U.S. attorney, went on to have a distinguished career, special assistant to the FBI, all these great things. But here's what is the truth. Chief Justice Gants is there whenever access to justice is an issue. Chief Justice Gants has mobilized and led the initiative by the other state chief justices to actually speak up on this issue. Chief Justice Gants has gone to the biggest mosque in New England at a time of Islamophobia and said to the people in the mosque, the rule of law is here for you. Chief Justice Gants has made access to justice something real, something meaningful, and that's why I'm so eager to hear this conversation. The fact that he was appointed initially to the bench by Governor Weld and then later elevated to being chief by Governor Patrick is of interest because they're all Harvard grads, so that's really nice. But it's also the case, and it just exemplifies Chief Justice Gantz's work and his character. These are, of course, governors from different parties. So he's a man for all seasons, and I couldn't be more thrilled that he's here. You all have already gotten to know Jim Greiner very, very well. I am not going to introduce him, but I am going to embarrass him. So just two things to say that I need to say about him. One, anyone who has ever had him as a professor in first year civil procedure knows something about randomization. But it's not about randomized trials. It's about a random number generator that he uses to call on people. And I see some people nodding. And I just want to say that for a whole swath of law students, it has turned the idea of randomization from terror to delight. So well done, Jim. The second thing is that Jim is a true seeker of the truth. Jim takes the methodology where it goes. This is why the work is so impressive and so important. Sometimes it shows that lawyers make a difference. Sometimes it shows that they don't. Sometimes it shows that postcards make a difference. Sometimes it shows that they don't. And because Jim is willing to pursue any and every discipline that will help advance the cause, whether it's from graphic design to actually talking with human beings, I just want to say I salute you, and now I look forward to the conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So His Honor has expressed the preference that we not go hide behind that table at a distance of what might appear a couple miles from folks in the back of the room, and instead that we circulate around. And you're mic'd up, and is it turned on?
I am mic'd up.
And is it turned on?
So
His Honor has also rejected the first three questions that I had planned to ask. On the grounds that they were too much about him and would have reviewed knowledge that folks already have. And so I will, when I launch in shortly, we are going to go straight to the hard, difficult stuff because that's quite frankly more interesting for everybody here, and I very much appreciate it. And thank you very much for doing this, Your Honor. Very much appreciate it. In terms of format, we probably will do some questions and answers from me for maybe sort of 15-ish to 20 minutes. And then we'll take a break so that you can get dessert if you haven't already gotten dessert, so a short break. And then I will invite everyone to come sit at a different table from the one that you're sitting, where you're sitting right now. And we'll take 15 to 20 minutes worth of questions from the audience, if that works for Your Honor.
Sure.
And then we will stop to give you a chance to reintroduce yourselves, hopefully to folks that you might not have met before. So that's where we're going to head it. So to launch right in, Your Honor, again, straight into the substance, a premise of the Access to Justice Lab is that the bench and the bar currently resist rigorous empiricism, especially via randomized control trials. under this view that the bench and the bar hold with respect to knowledge about what works and what doesn't. The bench and the bar focus exclusively on the accumulation of day-to-day experiences and on the pronouncements of elites within the profession. The Access to Justice Lab routinely makes an analogy to physicians in the 1940s, many of whom strenuously resisted randomized testing of new drugs. I guess right off the bat, are we right? To what extent are we right? And if we're wrong, why so?
You're wrong. I can't speak for the entire country, but certainly we don't. By the way, when you refer to the elites, does that include me?
Absolutely.
Really? I think if you sense there is some resistance out there, but I don't know that the resistance is to empiricism. The resistance may be to fear of what the results may show. And there's another question we'll be discussing in which that experience played out here in Massachusetts. It is always problematic if somebody brings in a study because they want the study to end up a certain way, and it might not turn out that way. So to the extent that people bring in Jim to do a study with the view that this will show something that we believe to be true, and it turns out that that may not necessarily be the result, or it may not be as clear, then there is a resistance to bringing in people because there is a view that it dilutes the message because it gets interfered with by facts and clumsy circumstances. There, I think, is a resistance because it's not that easy to do a controlled study. Life is more complicated than most experiments permit. The variables may not be so defined. When you speak about legal assistance, it's not as if there's legal assistance is one and no legal assistance is zero. We're always going to want to have some degree of legal assistance, and whether it's a lawyer for the day or whether it's going to be some kind of self-represented education or other effort, that makes it a more complicated study than a classic one versus zero in terms of the comparison. But I do think, certainly in Massachusetts, the third set of resistance is, and this is not only limited to access to justice, it is limited to our entire strategic planning effort. We have a strategic planning effort going on in the court system. It is actually a rather substantial strategic planning effort and is quite rigorous, not only with goals, but actually people who are supposed to be moving towards those goals and measuring it and being responsible for it. And if they don't do it, someone's going to yell at them. And then we expect certain things to happen within certain time frames. There were various measures there, but one measure that was not there was quality of justice. You could do speed of justice, you could do other types of measures, but there was no measure for quality of justice. And the question then is, isn't that the most important thing that we do? So why is there not a focus on the quality of justice? And then the next question is, well, everything we want to do in a strategic plan, we want to be able to measure. And we don't actually have great measuring sticks with regard to measures of quality. You can measure how quickly a jury is chosen, but you can't so easily measure how fair that jury is going to be. You can measure the speed with which you can adjudicate an eviction case, but you can't necessarily measure so easily the fairness of the outcome. And until we have justice measures, there is a concern that the things that may be measured may not necessarily be in keeping with what we think to be justice, and maybe push, and people push their focus to the metrics that are generated, there is a concern that you may be ending up in a world in which you are meeting your goals with regard to metric. You're choosing a jury quickly, but not necessarily choosing it fairly. And indeed, the jury analogy is not a bad one, because in Massachusetts, as a result of legislation, we moved to attorney voir dire about 3 years ago. It was extremely controversial when it happened because most judges did not want to do it. There was concern that it would mean that juries were going to be chosen more slowly, and that it would delay trials because it would take more time to choose juries. There was concern that it would require an increased number of jurors because it would take more jurors to select, more jurors in terms to be removed for cause or otherwise. And there was a concern that the personality of the attorneys would become more important in terms of what they may say, and judges would be losing control over what occurs, and we didn't want to be like New York or Connecticut, where they spend 2 or 3 days with the jurors without the presence of a judge saying God, Lord knows what in terms of selecting a jury. In fact, we have now moved to attorney voir dire. In fact, judges are slowly beginning to accept it as something which they think is a positive thing. They're still working between the issue of whether it's going to be done at sidebar versus whether it's going to be done in a panel voir dire, where questions are heard by all and you have to worry that someone's going to say something that is going to require you to start over. It has increased the amount of time it takes to choose a jury on average. We are doing metrics with regard to it. It has increased to some extent the number of jurors that we need to choose a trial, but there is a view that it actually is producing a fairer set of jurors, and that it may be, although I don't know if we have the metrics here, reducing the number of mistrials. Because to the extent that people are more carefully selecting jurors, the likelihood that you're going to have a juror who is going to turn out to be a problem juror, or is going to require, or is going to generate something that's going to produce a mistrial, is going to be done. But that is sort of a, that there is part of a cultural change in terms of recognizing it, identifying what metrics are done, and having this difficulty of trying to identify what constitutes a fair jury. So that gets played into a large part of this. But I think to the extent that we can measure what we do, we can learn whether it works or does not work, that is something which all of us want to hear. And the area where we're looking at it most carefully, perhaps not most successfully, is with regard to our specialty courts. Looking at issues with regard to our drug courts, reducing the rate of recidivism of those who enter. Are they truly cost-effective ways to do that? If you measure the recidivism rates only of those who graduate from drug court, then you're not including the one-third or so who drop out. And then the question is, how many resources are you putting into a drug court, and perhaps are there better ways those resources could be used? And similarly with regard to veterans courts and mental health courts, and is there a certain amount of self-selection? Right now, our drug courts in Massachusetts are almost entirely white, disturbingly so and strangely so. And the question of why that population is so white is something we are trying to take a look at, and that arguably could play into the issue of the whether or not they are truly successful, because then you have to get into racial issues. I don't know whether or not they are increasingly white because there is a view among African American and Latino jurors that this will turn out badly for them, that having a judge personally involved with their lives may not be a good thing, or because they're for whatever reasons not thought by probation to be good candidates for. But we are trying to learn what works and what does not work. And indeed, we did have a study called Hope More, which was a tough love type of program in which more higher risk defendants were brought in. The judge, the first violation would generally produce some consequence, and it had worked in Hawaii very successfully. It was studied. It's not clear that it's working around the country. So. And that has mattered in terms of the extent to which we are going to be embracing Hope More. So I think we do listen. It is hard. There's issues of culture with regard to it. But I don't think there's any particular resistance to learning whether or not what we are doing is working.
Mm-hmm. Let me pick up on any of the examples, but I'll use the jury one, because if I understood correctly, you made 4 or 5 causal statements that I would recognize or characterize as causal. That the introduction of voir dire, it may slow cases down, it may result in fewer mistrials, et cetera, et cetera. And as a scientist, I might say, well, how do you know that? Because it's a before and after study, and the cases might be changing in character around you. And so it's leading me to the next question is, you know, if you could imagine yourself 7 or 8 years ago, the Access to Justice Lab was in existence then, and it heard of a possible movement to go to voir dire in jury selection. What would we have said to persuade the judiciary, the legal community, to say, let's test this before we take it to the legislature? Let's do a randomized study to find out what the effect is on case outcomes, what the satisfaction is on the jury experience, whether you need more jurors, whether it slows cases down, each of the causal statements that you made.
And the response to that would be that you probably are not going to successfully do a randomized study because only judges who are willing to do it would be brought into the process, and there's a self-selection process there in terms of those judges who are prepared to accept it. Mm-hmm. It would only be in those cases in which the attorneys are prepared to accept mm-hmm. it, and that also would generate some self-selection. There mm-hmm. could be certain types of cases where they may be more interested in doing so. Mm-hmm. Generally, plaintiff's lawyers think they are more charming than defense lawyers and probably overestimate the extent to which they think they are charming. But that is why it would be, unless you are in a position in which you are going to say, we are going to randomly select judges to do this, and we're going to require attorneys to do it even though they don't want to, mm-hmm. then you can get a randomized study, but that's not going to happen.
And I guess that's where I want to follow up. Why not?
Because people don't tell judges what to do so easily. So, and if you do so and they do not want to do it, then you'd have your own set of issues as to the extent to which it would be.
And again, I don't want to overdo the law and the back and forth, but the legislature just did that. It did just tell the judges what they had to do. They had to allow the voir dire.
Right.
And so if there was a power to say, okay, we'll just have judges, we'll have the judicial volunteers, we'll do the randomized study with them. And they are the ones, but they have to volunteer. They're going to allow voir dire, but we'll randomize when it's allowable, and we'll say to the lawyers, you have the opportunity. Nobody's making you do voir dire. Is that, would any of this, you think, have resonated? And why not?
You could have arguably designed something along those lines, mm-hmm. getting attorneys who may not otherwise be obliged to, who have clients who may not necessarily wish it to accept it, mm-hmm. is not that easy. But yes, you could have identified the set of judges who say, I will be part of the study. Mm-hmm. And there were, in the Superior Court, a number of judges who volunteered to be a pilot with regard to so-called panel voir dire. That is, mm-hmm. most judges were somewhat comfortable with bringing jurors to sidebar and asking them questions, because if the answer was going to be, I don't think I can be fair because that person did something and which would require all of the jurors to be undone, you know it's being done in sidebar, only being heard by the judge. Mm-hmm. And a number of judges volunteered, I will try panel voir dire. That is what the attorneys preferred. It is a much more open process, a much scarier process, in which the judge loses much more control of it to the attorneys. But there are judges who did volunteer for that, mm-hmm. and there were studies being done of that. So, yep, so there is, but again, self-selected. So you have to get enough to self-select that you then have to do a control group.
Mm-hmm.
So the answer is you can, mm-hmm. But it's not so easy. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, getting large enough numbers to be able to have it be statistically significant raises other problems.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned this earlier. You were either fortunate enough or unfortunate enough, depending on your view, to be involved in some randomized studies that were done previous to, in particular, in the Massachusetts court system, one in a housing court and one in a district court with respect to summary eviction proceedings. And I think it's fair to say that the reactions both to the findings of those studies as well as to the fact that they were done in the context in which they were done, and that context, by the way, was as part of a project that was designed to try to support an effort to provide more lawyers to get more funding for legal services. The reaction, both in terms of the findings and the fact that the randomized study were done, were mixed in both the judiciary and in the legal community. I'm curious, what is your takeaway or set of takeaway messages from that experience? If you prefer, the issue of housing and lawyers and the role of in housing eviction proceedings, but also in the process of knowledge generation and randomized studies in particular.
The one thing that you learn is that if you don't do a study because you think you know what the outcome is going to be. So this was a study, I think it was paid for by the Boston Bar Foundation or Boston Bar?
The intervention, meaning the lawyers were paid for. We didn't get anything at all in terms
right,
of.
Right. But it was a grant, mm-hmm. and the mm-hmm. grant was designed really with the expectation that it would demonstrate that it matters a great deal if you have the full assistance of an attorney as opposed to not. So there was the control group did not get any special assistance beyond that which was ordinarily available. And the experimental group were that you had attorneys from GBLS who specialized in housing law who would represent you. And the first part of the theory of the hypothesis of the study was that it would matter a great deal if you had the full assistance of counsel. The second part of the study was to demonstrate that the results for tenants is much better in housing court than it would be in a district court because of all of the resources which a housing court has in terms of having housing specialists to provide mediation, judges who are knowledgeable in housing law. That was so the results of the study were supposed to be it matters a great deal that you have an attorney and tenants do better in housing court. And then life intervened. So
or data intervened.
Because why? Because there were two courts chosen. One was, the question was which district court would volunteer to do it. And the district court that volunteered to do it was the Quincy District Court. Why did Quincy District Court volunteer to do it? Because there's a very fine judge, Mark Coven, who actually takes a substantial interest in housing law. And he said, I would be happy. We actually take some pride here in Quincy, even though we have no resources with regard to doing it, so we were happy to house it. And in Quincy, they actually didn't. There was no lawyer for the day program in Quincy. There was no court service center. There really were no particular resources available to individuals who did not have counsel. And GBLS had two exceptional attorneys there who were extremely hardworking and extremely aggressive and extremely good. Then there was the housing court in the Northeast, which is Lynn and Lawrence, who had only one judge when they really needed two. They had a lawyer for the day program, which was run by Northeast Legal Services. And then they provided, and that was essentially the control group, because they always had a lawyer for the day program there. And the experimental group was the full-time services of attorneys who also were from Northeast Legal Services. Okay, so how did the study turn out? Well, it turned out that in Quincy, the folks who had these two attorneys did extraordinarily well. The tenants who had them as clients did unbelievably well, much better than those who were in the Northeast Housing Court with the full assistance of attorneys. Why? Well, because what happened in Quincy was these folks would prepare for trial. And they had a judge, Judge Coven, who would say, I will give you a trial date. So I will give you a trial date, and you told counsel, if they win, they are entitled to attorney's fees. And if it's a 93A case, which is our consumer fraud, they'd be entitled to treble damages. So basically, I will give you a trial date, and if they win, then they may get damages as well as attorney's fees and treble damages. When you speak to Mark, to Judge Coven, and say, what did you do? He would say, I didn't do anything. Those cases never tried. He didn't die. I don't think any of those cases ever tried. But they had a trial date. You had attorneys who were working their tail off on the weekend to be ready for trial, and then all of the cases settled at extraordinarily favorable outcomes for the tenants who were involved because they had basically faced, they were all ready to go to trial and they were very possibly going to win, and then the landlords would basically carve out a deal which was extremely favorable for them. That's what happened in Quincy. It wasn't supposed to happen in district court because district court doesn't have any of the services of a housing court. Then you went to the Northeast Housing Court, and what happened? What happened is there was only one judge And the fact of the matter is, the lawyers for the day were doing much of what was done by the persons who were providing full legal assistance. And they all, because there was only one judge who could not generally give you a trial date because of the volume of work, everybody was pushed into mediation with the housing specialist. And the housing specialist essentially said, listen, I've heard this argument. I know what this judge is going to do. It's not going to wash with the judge. And the range of outcomes that occurred in mediation was actually relatively narrow because the mediators essentially were driving it. The attorneys were not seeking to truly go to trial, in part because they feared the whole system would break down if they actually did go to trial because there was only one judge. So they didn't actually push for trial. They didn't prepare for trial. They essentially made it clear that this case can be resolved by mediation. And even those who didn't have counsel had a lawyer for the day, providing them with enough information to get through the... So the range of outcomes was actually relatively narrow. And so at the end of it, instead of saying that you're much better off in housing court than in district court, which is what all of us sort of believed, it turned out that you were better off with Dick Bauer and Stephanie Blandis in Quincy district court than you would have been in the Northeast housing court. And it screwed up your study because it wasn't supposed to turn out that way. And then they were upset with you because it turned out that that the results didn't necessarily support the proposition, and since the hypothesis was going to be we need full legal assistance in all these cases, we need civil Gideon, and it turned out to be much more complicated than that, they were not happy with how it played out. Mm-hmm. So is that a fair...
I think I just would add one detail, which is that the treated group and the control group in Northeast had remarkably similar outcomes to the control group in the district court. In other words, the group that didn't have lawyers in the court that was supposed to be a good deal less accessible. And that was, I think, part of what creeped everybody out, which was the idea that the housing court, which was this much more accessible place, the outcomes for both the full representation and limited assistance group very closely matched the outcomes for the no assistance group in the less accessible court system. And I think that was one of the things that led to
because even those without counsel were going before Judge Coven.
Right.
Who was generally sensitive to these issues and produce a relatively fair result.
But this was what led to the issue in your second point, which was that this was supposed to show that the housing court was the better place to be.
Right.
And the data simply wouldn't support that.
Right, right. Now, we actually, after this was done, I brought other judges in. This is why I know that Mark Coven said he didn't do anything. I said, you screwed up the whole study. I said, I didn't do anything. I just said there's a trial date, and then they never tried. But there are indeed lessons to be learned. One is that it matters a great deal, first of all, who the judge is. We sort of know that, that the judge has enormous power to actually provide a quality of justice or not in his or her courtroom. It matters a great deal that you do something basically simple, like I will give you a trial date, and if you win, I will give you the damages to which you are entitled by law. Okay, that seems pretty basic, but the fact of the matter in Northeast, where they basically didn't have any realistic hope of actually getting a trial date, they didn't have that opportunity and they lost that bargaining stick. Mm-hmm. The lesson also is learned is that if Northeast, frankly, had been more aggressive and saying, no, we have a right to trial, we insist upon going to trial, then the results probably could have been very different. But they were more a matter of, we need to make this housing court work, we have limited resources, we need to settle these cases in mediation, and we're going to settle them within the typical range that the housing specialist thought was basically the reasonable fair range. So you need to worry that housing specialists are not necessarily doing, they're moving cases, and part of what a housing specialist does is move a case because there are 80 people going into a housing court in the morning and during an eviction day, and you need to get them out. But you need to worry about how that happens, you need to worry whether the housing specialists are truly providing a fair quality of justice and truly giving you the chance for trial, whether they're focused on moving cases. So now, there were some interesting outcomes of the case. One is that Stephanie Blandis now is in Northeast, and the fact that she moved actually from GBLS to Northeast is actually not unrelated to what we learned as a result of the study, was that you need to have having aggressive counsel matters a great deal. So there were lessons learned, not necessarily the lessons that people hoped would be learned, but it also shows how complicated it is to be able to get a fair result, because the fact of the matter is Judge Coven is an unusual judge in district court. There are five judges as knowledgeable of housing law as there are among the 60 or 80 in district court, but because he was the person willing to house it, you got him. We had yesterday, a matter comes on my computer, there's a motion to stay of a woman who had been evicted. She has 9 children, she's pregnant with her 10th. She was evicted, and the judge gave her some additional time. She sought a stay, it was denied by the single justice, and it comes up to the full court to say, are we going to extend the stay, which was scheduled for yesterday, to end? And she has no attorney. She's written this pro se, handwritten thing, which describes she has 9 children, she's going to be homeless, her children have asthma. She actually has some money because of I'm not sure whether it's a SSI or some other means. What do we do? So it did not escape my attention that person had not been in a housing court, where they would have had the resources perhaps of a housing specialist and of what we call the Tenancy Preservation Program, which actually is a group that's very much involved in preventing homelessness, especially among women like her. And if she had been in housing court, maybe that would not have been the result. But she went to the Malden District Court, and that was the result that occurred. It also occurred that she did not appear to have any access to counsel with regard to it. But it turns out that we have a pro bono appellate program, which has just been created, and Wednesday, today, happens to be pro bono appellate day, in which they were, so we actually extended the stay till Friday at noon, with the clerk being directed that she can come in today, this morning, to the pro bono appellate program, and we can see whether or not the pro bono appellate attorney can produce a better outcome than we have. I don't know how it has played out, but it is an interesting example of what a housing court actually may mean, is because there are many better outcomes than this person had. When she comes to the Supreme Judicial Court on the last day of the already extended time to evict, it's not really the best time to begin to think about alternative resolutions. But you look at that and you say, that's somebody who it could have turned out differently, with a different court, different resources, different access to counsel. And I'd like to tell you that I know how the story ends, but I don't know how the story ends. So perhaps in a few days, perhaps by Friday at noon, when the stay ends, we'll know whether or not that woman found an alternative to homelessness. But it's an example of how this thing does blend in, how having an attorney and how having how a housing court arguably could make a big difference. And so that's sort of the other edge of the equation.
Just one comment about the difficulty in scheduling a trial. If I recall this correctly, there is a right to jury trial in Massachusetts summary eviction cases, and there was in one of the 4 locations, at least, where the housing court in those 2 studies sat, there was no place for the jury to sit. And so you actually could not have held a jury trial in that location without scheduling it somewhere else in another physical location that would have interfered with the ongoing proceedings there.
Right. And to which the evicted tenant perhaps had no transportation.
Has no transportation to get to.
So
let me ask one more question, then we'll take the promised break and invite everyone again to sit at a different table. Speaking generally, how do you think the Access to Justice Lab can be most constructive in promoting access to justice in Massachusetts? In recall, it's a lab. In Massachusetts, across the country, across the world.
The key issue is identifying the right hypothesis, and identifying areas where we think we can do better and measurably so. So, I mean, I know that you're involved in the debt collection world. That's a world where we're spending actually a fair amount of time and energy. I know that you are focusing on trying to reduce the rate of defaults and receiving some relatively modest success, but only modest success.
Absolutely.
I have been pushing, although it turns out to be harder than it seems, although I know some states are doing it, the idea of getting text alerts to individuals so that they, everybody who's poor, not everybody, but almost everybody who's poor has almost nothing, but they do have a smartphone. And the numbers are, of those are actually increasing. And if you read the wonderful book, which I guess is by the book of called Scarcity, which I commend, which I commend to all in terms of the extent to which various people have scarcities, whether it be of time, like most of us, or of money, like most of the rest of the world, and perhaps some of us. But the ability to actually keep track of a schedule, when especially if you're homeless, it's not so easy. I mean, we have a case. I'm not sure we're taking it yet, but. Sexual offender is supposed to register annually, especially if you're homeless, you have to register more often. And one day after the deadline, the person is arrested and charged with failure to register. And I think one of the issues which we may take the case is were the jury instructions with regard to intent appropriate. But you look at it, you think about it, and the person is homeless. They're not exactly, what's the likelihood that they're going to say, well, let's see what our schedule is for the day, and be able to go through their calendar and say, oh, I put a tickler that it's now 3 months, and maybe or not maybe they received a letter in the mail, but they're homeless, so where is the letter to go? We need to figure out ways in which we can prompt people who are, for all kinds of reasons, very busy, often disorganized, all sorts of issues which may prevent them from actually knowing where they should be at a certain time. We also need to persuade people that it matters that they go, because after all, almost all of them actually do owe the money, and telling them that if you come, the result may be better than having to pay the entirety of your credit card bill is something hard for a court to communicate. I mean, a court can't basically say, if you come, something better than simply a verdict for the defendant, it likely can emerge, but it can't happen if you come. So you're working on the issues of default. We're also working on what happens when they do default. I know Erica was involved in doing that, and those rules are still pending to see whether or not judges can be scrutinize those, because the vast number of persons default. And then for those people who don't default, making sure that they have some access to counsel and appropriate services. But the fact of the matter is, we're probably getting about 20 or 30% who are not defaulting. So 4 out of 5 of them are ending up defaulting, ending up before, with a judge with a default judgment. So we're trying to look at it both in terms of reducing the default rate, trying to make a judge require perhaps more with regard to a default, especially since people who are poor often move around more and are evicted and don't necessarily. So yes, it was mailed to the last known address, but maybe that last known address was never an address, but not just where they've lived for the last 6 months and never received it. And then also focusing on what happens for those people who do come, to what extent something can happen. And then, of course, the other issue is a very delicate issue, is to what extent do judges get involved in evaluating the fairness of settlement. Discussed at the Access Justice Commission 3 years ago, enormous judges were not comfortable with evaluating the fairness of a settlement. In part because the model is when the parties are at peace, then our role is simply to to generally approve it. Now, if you're a probate and family court judge, you have a legal obligation. If it's going to be an alimony settlement, you have a legal obligation to ensure it is fair. So the culture of a probate and family court judge is very different from the culture of other judges who don't necessarily see it as their legal obligation to do so. That culture isn't reinforced by the law because they must make a finding regarding its fairness, and that obligation is not in other courts. But probably not responsive at all to your question. But those are, but those are the kind of things which go into how do you make debt collection fairer, and to what extent you're able to measure issues of measure the fairness of a result, to what extent you're actually changing the proportion to which the debt of pay. Those are, that's measurable. I mean, debt is one good thing about debt collection is it's money, and money is measurable, and so you can actually do some measures there. But that is the, those are the kind of problems that we are looking at. You know, to what extent can we reduce the rate of homelessness and evictions? And to what extent can we do that better if we learn earlier about the eviction? To what extent can programs which exist, like Home Start, which actually have private money, which can provide loans to people who may have medical issues? I know there's people involved in bankruptcy. Where's their student involved in bankruptcy? He was here before.
He's back there.
You know, to what extent, if we learn about it early enough, can that change the rate in which people end up? And probably measurable in the sense that one really bad result of an eviction is the storage of goods. It's bad for the landlord who has to pay for it. It's bad for the tenant because their stuff is being stored in some god-awful facility for whatever period of time. Is that a good measure or arguable measure of failure in terms of a housing court? The extent to which people's property ends up in storage, because that means that even when they agreed upon a date, it didn't happen. So, I mean, you know, a good result may be I'll give you 60 days, but you have to be out of here in 60 days. And that may be enough time for them to find other housing, maybe enough time for them to figure out what they can do and avoid that. But once you get into storage, then that's a bad result for all. And arguably, if you can measure the extent to which we are producing bad results, and they vary by different courts, then you may be able to make all the people who are unhappy with you happier again if you can show that housing court is a place where the rate of storage is ultimately lower.
On that note, why don't we take the little break that I mentioned? And folks, you have to move because you're going to switch tables somewhere and introduce yourself to someone else. And you can certainly go get dessert and another drink, and we'll reconvene in about 6 minutes.
I sat with the Chief Justice of Washington State. And the thing they're working on, based on tribal custom, is healing circles.
There we go.
So you need to create new healing circles.
So basically, the only way I will ask a question at this point is if there's absolute and total silence for 300 consecutive seconds. 5 minutes. Okay? So basically, we would like to hear
from you.
You
don't need to do that because I have my law clerk for next year here. And
yes,
that's
exactly.
Her job is going to be to ask me very difficult questions very soon. Exactly. So it's not so bad if she gets started right away.
We'll deputize Maya
She has to learn to tell me I'm wrong.
Right.
That's one of the first things she has to learn. Every law clerk is required to read the Malcolm Gladwell piece about the Korean airline crash. So, where everybody was too polite to tell the pilot that he should avert course, and it turned out very badly. So that is the lesson that every law clerk has to learn, is they have to keep me from crashing.
So you're on the spot. Would you like to lead us off? Here we go. We're gonna give you a microphone. So.
That's why you were hired.
And so who are you? Don't you introduce yourself to me?
My name is Maya. I am a 3L, and I've taken Civ Pro with Professor Greiner. I've also had the opportunity to do a little bit of research on his work related to pretrial risk assessments. So I'm going to try and see if I can take your advice to heart and challenge you a little bit on something that you said earlier. You mentioned that the problem with using empirical studies in this context is that sometimes it's difficult to measure justice. There aren't any good measuring sticks. I think maybe 3 years ago, I would have definitely agreed with you 100%, but I've worked with Professor Greiner, so I've been converted to an extent. So for example, in the research that we've done on pretrial risk assessments, you know, there are outcomes that can be measured that do indicate the quality of justice, right? The ability to measure outcomes like failure to appear, future criminal activity, and it's not hard for me to imagine that there are other measurable outcomes in other contexts. So I'm curious to hear, as a judge, and maybe this will make more sense, not for an appellate judge, but for a trial judge, so you might have to imagine a little bit.
I did that too.
Right, or cast your mind back a little bit.
It's not that foreign. It's 8 years ago, but I still remember.
So casting your mind back, if you're a judge and you want to keep yourself honest, you want to ensure that you are sticking to a certain standard of quality in the decisions that you're making, what are some of the metrics that you'd want to know if you could like design a longitudinal study of your decisions over time? What are some of the outcomes that you would want to measure and know about?
Okay, you're fired.
Oh, no. I knew I shouldn't have come.
You are correct in that. I did not mean to suggest that there are no justice measures, although I probably did say that, so you're quite correct to edit me. It's good practice. You'd be editing me in that regard, because that was what you heard and probably what I, but not what I meant to say. I meant to say it's hard to think through what are good justice measures, but I do think it is possible. So, and I do think it's important to do. So your points are all correct in that we do need justice measures. There are, I think, justice measures. In terms, and I think there are three parts. The pretrial risk assessment is interesting, and I was speaking with Erica about it earlier, because it's a good example of what is challenging for us and what is important to have interaction between we who are judges and you who are in the academic world, because we looked carefully at the Arnold risk assessment stuff, and you're absolutely right. There are measurable things, which are there. Recidivism is measurable, although it turns out to be not so easy to get everybody to use the same recidivism measurements. So we have different sheriffs in different counties, and they use different recidivism measures. So it matters whether or not how long the period of time is. It measures whether you're measuring conviction after 3 years versus arrest after 3 years. It matters whether you're measuring return to custody after 3 years, because that can include violations of probation and parole, which may not involve criminal conduct. It also matters how aggressive probation and parole is in terms of violating you. Parole in Massachusetts is very aggressive in violating you and will violate you for things that are not crimes. And if you look just at that, you'll say it's an incredibly high recidivism rate, but that's because parole will violate you for a whole lot of things. And indeed, one of the parole conditions that is standard in Massachusetts is you should have no contact with anybody who has a criminal record. And if you look at the demographics of crime, that means that about 98% of the people who go home to their communities are already going to be in violation of their parole conditions, which means that you're then giving an enormous amount of authority to a parole officer to decide whether or not he or she wishes to violate you. So even if you sort of say recidivism is a measure, getting everybody to agree on what is a common measure and thinking through it matters. But we want to use a risk assessment measure, but we can't use Arnold. Why can't we use Arnold? Because Arnold has, I think, what, four or five variables, of which two of them are likelihood of committing a violent offense and likelihood of committing a criminal offense. And in Massachusetts, as a matter of federal constitutional law, The SJC said many years ago, a judge may not hold somebody in custody awaiting trial based on dangerousness unless the person receives due process. And as a result of that decision, there was a requirement that there be a dangerousness hearing, and the DA has to apply for it only for certain crimes. And there's a so if we use the Arnolds, then we are effectively holding people based on dangerousness, which we can't do without a due process hearing. And the question is, what should the due process hearing look like? A lot of DAs say, well, we can't in the district court. We have thousands of cases. We can't do a dangerousness hearing for all of them. Are we going to lower the standard for dangerousness, which may be something we may need to do, and change the amount of process that's provided, and maybe it can be adequate? And will that actually increase or decrease the rate of people being held? I don't know. But we're looking at the whole issue of bail, but is it problematic with regard to the use of Arnold because it uses factors that are forbidden by law? And the other issue is, I think Arnold views its stuff as proprietary, and if a defense lawyer were to say, we wish to challenge it on constitutional grounds, so we want to look to see what exactly, we want to go inside this and be able to see to what extent it could be based on issues which may be racially biased or could be incorporating issues of criminal offenses that may be illegal, then Arnold will say, we can't give you the data, and then we have to be faced with, what do you do when you can't get inside the data? So we're looking for, and we've asked Arnold, can we just use your risk of flight assessment, and they won't let us do that. But that is, so arguably we may need to create our own risk data, but that takes a long time because you're measuring recidivism, you need time, and you need to wait a period of time, and it's, and you need to get large enough numbers. But so that is sort of a good example of stuff we are quite willing to do because we do know that judges are doing their own risk assessment. We do know that a judge is saying, I don't want to let this person who's been charged with a sexual assault out, even though they have substantial roots in the community, because I worry the person may commit another crime. No one is moved for dangerousness, but I can't hold them because they're dangerous, but I can hold them because they have a risk of flight. So I can say, well, it's a serious crime, you're facing a long sentence, evidence against you is strong, I'm going to give you a high bail because I fear that, for fear that you may flee, and because of the lengthy sentence, I'm going to give you bail of $20,000, which I know you can't meet, and you're effectively holding the person because you know that they're not going to be able to make that bail, and you're doing it in part because of issues of dangerousness, and the responses wouldn't be better if we had it actually accurate and measurable. But we're sort of, those are the things we are actually very much involved with in trying to figure out what to do with issues of bail. And bail is complicated because while there are things we can affirmatively do with regard to sentencing, which we feel very good are going to be better, I worry we actually have a relatively low rate of detention with regard to bail, though it's higher than it should be, and it's lower than a net. But I do worry that if we actually were to move to a model that moved money out and dropped the standard for dangerousness, I don't know whether or not that would increase or not. It might or it might not, but I have to worry that we may be trying to fix something and make it worse. That's something which we are mindful of in the bail area, which I don't worry about so much in terms of, I don't worry that if we drop mandatory minimums, it'll make things worse. I'm quite comfortable that judges know how to sentence and can do so. So I don't sit there and worry that this may turn out badly. But when we looked at some of the bail stuff, and you know, when they identified a number of people who were being held in $100 bail and said, that's terrible, why should someone be held in $100 bail? Most of those cases, it turned out, were people who actually the attorney did not want them to make bail for one of two reasons. One is because they already were serving, they already had a high bail in, say, Plymouth County, and if they got bailed, if they made the bail in Suffolk, they would not get credit for the time that they were serving. So if they wanted credit for the time served, they had to not make bail. So the idea is, give me a bail, Your Honor, and then we'll not make it because I want credit for the time being served since it's being served elsewhere. And the other reason, and coming increasingly important, is, Your Honor, if he makes bail, there's an ICE detainer, and upon making of bail, he could be picked up and deported. He doesn't want to be deported. He'd rather wait and hope that something good happens. But the ICE detainer issue becomes a whole nother issue in terms of what happens with regard to the release, because ICE will not, if ICE has you, they will send you away. And when you call the case, where are you? Well, ICE has deported them. Nobody asked us about it, they just do it. And so people may want to stay in jail hoping that something good will happen for fear of that. In terms of the third issue you mentioned of what judges would need to know, it feeds into issues of implicit bias. I mean, I have spent a lot of time talking to judges about mindfulness. A lot of what judges do, which is not so good, are things that they just don't think very hard about because it's always been done that way. So, especially in district courts, where things move incredibly fast and there are a whole lot of people there and people are doing things because they've already done it. And there is a value to stopping to think as to what is it that we are doing. And, you know, there's, for instance, one example recently discussed is in district court, it's relatively common for somebody to get a relatively minor charge and for the judge to say, I will dismiss it upon payment of $100 in court costs, okay? It happens all the time. Generally, the defendant is pleased. He or she avoids a criminal record because there's no conviction. They get $100. The judge can say, well, I've taught him a lesson. He shouldn't do it again. But what happens when the person doesn't have $100? Well, if the person doesn't have, it's a dismissal upon payment of it. And if you don't pay, then arguably that charge remains and comes back. And do people stop and think, is that fair for somebody who can't afford the $100? And a lot of people just don't think about it. But we're asking them now to think about ability to pay and all the things that happen with regard to ability to pay. We had this issue with regard to so-called fine time, where judges were putting people in jail because they had not paid their fines and they were not doing ability to pay hearings, which they required constitutionally to do. And if anybody had appealed the matter to the SJC, they would have won. But nobody appealed anything, and in part because some of them didn't have counsel, because some of them were not assigned counsel, because after all, there was no chance they were going to go to jail. They were given a small fine. And if you don't have any prospect of going to jail, you may not be entitled to counsel. So all this went under the radar. A lot of judges who were just did it because that's the way that it always been done, and nobody thought very hard about it. So in terms of being able to look at things and be able to, it was a report on the fines which got our attention. I did not know it was happening. So in terms of whether reports and studies matter, yeah, they matter to help us be mindful of things that we're not mindful about. And of course, the biggest issue, not the biggest, but a big issue is issues of implicit racial bias and the extent to which you can get measurable things for that. That's obviously an incredibly delicate issue, and issues to whether or not it's going to be public. Does a judge want data that may arguably suggest that that person is racially biased and then have to deal with that? And judges are not terribly eager about that, even though they may actually want to be able to learn themselves whether or not they're doing things which may turn out to have racial bias effects. Those are other issues that we're trying to confront. But helping issues of mindfulness relate to ability to be able to see things that are happening and see from a different perspective. And that's another way in which, you know, I refer to it as the emperor has no clothes. So, you know, I mean, as a Superior Court judge for many years, I'm sure that with regard to sex offenders who are committed to certain crimes, the statute says they were to get lifetime community parole supervision. That was part of the required sentence. So if somebody had a certain crime, you would say, I'll give you this and this, and then you're also required by statute to have parole supervision for life. I'm sure I did it. Nobody thought too hard about it until a clever attorney said, what is this thing? It's not really parole, because parole is always within the confines of a judge's sentence. Parole generally means a judge has sentenced you to 3 to 5 years. That's what the judge has sentenced you, and the parole board, which is the executive, has the ability to release you before the 5 years are up. But it can't keep you beyond the 5 years. It's only all parole is it will tell you where you must serve that sentence. Parole supervision for life was after the 5 years are done, then for the rest of your life, if you commit a violation, you can be put in, you can be put in jail for some period of time. That's done entirely by the executive. And somebody said, this is in violation of the separation of powers. You're permitting the executive to impose a sentence above and beyond what a judge imposed. It's not truly parole, and we declare it unconstitutional. But I declare it was my opinion, joined by a court that was unanimous, when comprising mostly of superior court judges who probably just did it, because nobody stopped to say that the emperor had no clothes. So that's one of the great things about law school clinical programs, that they have the ability, because they don't know anything, to begin to ask stuff like, why is this? Why do we do this? And all the people who know things will say, well, that's the way it is. And so it takes for the you law students to say the emperor has no clothes and to wonder whether or not that is true. So that can be a great blessing for people to be raising stuff that people take for granted. So. I've worn you out. I've worn you out.
This is more for you, Jim. Hearing Justice Gants describe very persuasively the explanation for what happened in the Quincy District Court and the Northeast Housing Court, I wonder why you ever thought that study had any hope of success. because you know, we lawyers are so good at compiling explanations and causal theories about all this stuff that to a scientist are pretty unfounded. But do we throw ourselves into a place where those kinds of explanations were just inevitable? And can you take that into account when planning a study in advance to know whether it makes sense to do that?
So in this particular study, I was brought in, or actually wormed my way in would be the more accurate verb. After the study had been planned, the sites had been chosen, the money had been allocated, and basically about 2 or 3 months before the pilot was to begin. And basically, at that particular point, the folks in the Boston Bar Association and others were looking for an evaluation, and I said to them, I will do it for free if you will let me randomize. That's my only cost, is I will do it for free and let me randomize. I don't know whether had they known what randomization entailed and how it meant a loss of utter control over the findings of the study, whether they would have agreed. I don't think they did know at the time that that meant that you didn't get to control the results of the study, the substantive results, the conclusions of the study ahead of time with randomization. And so, but you do bring up a very good point, which is to say that in general, a scientist or anyone in the field needs to consider site selection, setting selection, subject area, et cetera, very carefully. Studies that are foregone conclusions are not interesting and not informative. If there is very, very strong reason to believe that the study is going to come out in a particular way, you shouldn't do it. And that's true as a matter of science. It also turns out to typically be true as a matter of ethics. Which is to say that you're typically going to having to be randomized people, and unless you have, a very strong scarcity situation, then you may lack an ethical basis to randomize them to something that you know or you have really, really strong reason to believe is an inferior situation for them. Now, if there's scarcity, you might be able to make an argument about, well, you know, there's not enough to go around anyway, et cetera. But this is something that any good scientist, any good lawyer would think about ahead of time. With all respect, His Honor and I have slightly different views about the level of certainty of some of the conclusions, and I do certainly agree that many of the suggestions that His Honor has made are plausible and, in fact, even likely. I think there are other possible explanations as well for those particular findings, and this is sort of a discussion that Your Honor and I have had several times, which is, and in fact, we raised at our full session, how cautious should the scientists be in making conclusions that might have obvious policy implications. Because, you know, in one sense, if I agree that His Honor's read of the studies is the most likely, how confident should I be making policy recommendations on that when there's no scientific argument that I have ruled out other plausible explanations? So.
And that touches upon another concern that I guess, feeds into it. One concern is basically, if you can't give us lessons learned and they're sufficiently equivocal, then we sort of say, well, we're not quite sure what to do with it.
Right.
And especially if we need some of those lessons learned to persuade others that we should go ahead with it, that makes it harder for us. The other concern is, and I think it was mentioned in one of your questions before, is it is hard for us to get to do things during any particular time frame. And there is some concern that if it's going to do a study, then that means we could be 2 or 3 years delayed in doing something, and some of us may not be sure we're going to be here in 2 or 3 years, or at least the enthusiasm that we have now may have waned before that happens. So there is a view that, you know, we think this is going to make things better. We want to move and do it, and then have you study it, as opposed to we want to put a controlled, we may do a pilot, but there's always a tension between getting things done and having it properly studied and verified. Because it's hard to get a whole lot of stuff done, and judges all have their day jobs. And whatever we ask them to do with regard to these other things, as Mark knows, is above and beyond our usual day job, and that's a scarce resource which we need to be mindful of. And so getting people together and saying we're going to get things done by Christmas makes a huge difference. But if we say it's going to be a 3-year project, then it's awful hard to sustain that degree of energy and enthusiasm.
And again, just to pick up on that last comment, one of the challenges that we have in trying to get this work done is to say, work out a situation where you say, okay, you have political will, you have momentum, you have a moment in which you can do something. Do it. Actually go for it. Let's evaluate it at the same time. But do it. Don't stop, but evaluate at the same time. And I am optimistic that there are creative ways in which those two things can be managed. Next question. Yeah, Steve, right across.
So we're.
Why don't you identify yourself?
Steve Epler-Epstein, Connecticut Legal Services. Mm-hmm. So we're at a point where randomized controlled trial is maybe getting a little bit of liftoff in our closed world. But it seems to me we've touched on two things that I see as structural challenges that are still really significant barriers when we think about trying to collect data and really look at the provision of justice. One's illustrated by the conversation you just had about all these different interpretations of the studies that were done, and you know, in other areas where people do significant research, there's a study, there's some results, everybody argues over the results, and they use those arguments to design the follow-up studies. And we're nowhere near follow-up studies, and that seems to me a significant barrier. The other, which you also touched on, I think, Your Honor, is the problem of, well, what if we do a study and nobody cares and nobody listens? And the particular example I'd like to ask you about is the data that was published some years ago about the effect of time of day on decision making, which was spread, you know, through a lot of our circles by the New York Times, right? This is not a well-kept secret at this point. And I'm curious whether in any state, whether you know of any state doing anything with that data in their work with judges or other decision makers about dealing with what appears to be some knowledge about the effect of time of day.
This is the Israeli study,
yeah,
with regard to sentences, which basically said you should not be sentenced before lunch.
Well, right after breakfast is okay,
after lunch is okay.
Late afternoon, you don't have a chance.
You don't want to do it. I'm aware of that. I don't, and it's interesting you measure it because everybody hears that and listens, but nobody really believes it, frankly.
Nobody believes it?
I don't think anybody believes it.
Ah,
so
that's
now, it may be, and that is because to believe it is to fundamentally challenge. I mean, I guess it's easier to believe that, you know, the extent to which your sugar level drops is going to affect the length of sentence, easier to believe that than there are also studies that indicate that the darkness of someone's skin is positively correlated with the length of sentence. That is an even scarier, and I've seen that study, and you go, whoa, I mean, that, you know, that light-skinned blacks do better than dark-skinned. The more African the features, the longer the length of sentence, which was presented to us.
I'm
sorry?
There's lots of courts running implicit bias projects.
Right, right, that was presented to the all of Massachusetts judges at our implicit bias conference, which we had in September 2015. That was one I'm looking at, saying, I mean, whoa. I think people recognize that, and it's sort of interesting that when you mentioned that to, and I don't think I embarrass her, but mentioning at the SJC, and we have Justice Hines, and she says, of course, everybody. Blacks have recognized that for a long time, that is something which they sort of understood. You know, their view was that Barack Obama would never have won if his features were more African than they were. That was something which was entirely obvious to somebody who was 68 years old and been very involved in the civil rights movement and was sort of focused on it. That was not at all a surprise to her. It was a surprise and incredibly alarming to me, and I think to others. But I don't know that the time of day necessarily, but it goes to the issue of you can have some data, it's only one study. I don't know what the nature is of the Israeli criminal sentencing system in terms of whether or not they sentence more people than we do in a day. And it's, of course, most of our sentences are agreed upon with and defense lawyers. So. But it is an interesting idea of the extent to which there are certain studies we say we just don't believe it, and therefore they don't matter even if they're true, because it challenges some fundamental views of what we are and what we do. So much as, you know, back in law school, the legal realists of the 30s were focused on, you know, how a judge decides depends upon whether he had breakfast that day. That was the classic legal realism view, but judges resist that. But that's a matter of the extent to which certain things are so, people are so resistant to learn it that the measure of the proof has to be that much better to be able to do it, which focuses on truly randomized study.
For example, what if we randomize the order and the time of day in which cases would come, if you're going to have them? Or, to your second point, what if we randomized whether the judge can actually see the defendant? We blinded the judge to the race of the defendant and saw and randomized that and measured case outcomes. So those are, for instance, two studies that we might do that would shed light on those. I would be anxious to do them.
No, and there'd be some constitutional issues. I guess you could volunteer it. And then, of course, we want judges to know more about defendants. To say we're going to know almost nothing about you.
No, sorry, blinding to the physical, the face-to-face interaction.
Right.
Not
right,
anything
right,
else.
Right.
But
I mean,
blinding
and then, of course,
the,
and I mean, there was
screen.
An interesting.
I'm
I mean,
just arguing that a clerk bring me a cup of tea and a
Well, that may be. If it makes you feel better, even though you're not from Massachusetts, I don't know what Chase Rogers does in her court, in the Connecticut Supreme Court. You're a very fine Chief Justice, but when I came on the court, the custom during Sambal, which is after the argument, the discussion we have in consultation, was that only water could be brought into the room. So you'll be pleased to know that there is abundant sugar that is now being brought in to the SJC. Justice Lowy has a terrific Jewish bakery in Swampskit, and now we've all gained weight as a result of our deliberations.
Just a final thought on the blinding. Best way to hire lots of female orchestral players? Let them audition behind the screen. Otherwise, you get all male orchestras. We are out of time, Your Honor, and thank you very much for your time. And thank you very much for everyone here and everyone who prepared and helped to put this event on, in particular The only obligation before you go is, if you have not yet had a chance to introduce yourself to the folks sitting around your table, introduce yourself to the folks sitting around your table, and then we will let you go. So, thank you so much.